They are millions of times more powerful than our most powerful digital computer. The quantum computers will be in the cloud, and you will access it with your wristwatch, your contact lens. You'll blink, and then you'll have access to the computing power.
The rise of quantum computing signals a potential shift in global security. This machine could fundamentally change our understanding of encryption and decryption. You know, a method similar to putting a lock to keep your belongings safe. And this is not without concern. Quantum computers could crack any existing digital code. The most sensitive information of nations, like military and defense strategies, they all could be vulnerable to quantum hacking. But let's not concentrate solely on the downsides. This technology also holds promise for numerous scientific advancements, like more efficient cars, rockets, and energy solutions. Even unlocking secrets of the universe, like the Big Bang or the mysteries of black holes.
There's a description of a black hole that doesn't involve gravity, only involves quantum mechanics. The quantum processes in that quantum world mimic the kinds of processes that people have been developing for quantum computing, quantum error correction code. And the dictionary shows that the quantum error correcting code may be the reason why space-time itself holds together.
So why do countless companies invest hundreds of millions in building the world's most powerful quantum computers? Back in the 1980s, theoretical physicist Richard Feynman ran into a problem. He was trying to comprehend the quantum world, which consists of delicate, tiny particles. To simulate these particles, Feynman desired to use a computing machine. But as he added more particles to the simulation, his computer struggled to keep up. Then, he had an ingenious idea. What if he made a tool that was made from the tiny particles themselves? Essentially a quantum computer that would enable exploration of the intricate world of the small physics.
Because nature is ultimately quantum mechanical, and things rapidly get out of hand as soon as you get too many quantum systems, it becomes impractical to simulate on a classical computer. So Feynman developed the idea of a quantum computer, and Feynman also realized that a quantum computer was not a Turing machine, it was a machine of a different kind.
To understand how a quantum computer works, we have to understand why it's called quantum. First of all, the building blocks of a classical computer are called bits. They resemble switches, existing either in a zero or one state, also known as binary information. On the other hand, quantum computers use something called quantum bits, or qubits. This advantage stems from their capacity to exist in numerous states simultaneously. It's very different from the classical computers that can only be in one state at a time. You can visualize them as arrows in a three-dimensional space. Pointing upwards signifies a zero state. Downwards represents a one state, pretty much similar to a classical bit. But this is what makes quantum computers so special. These qubits can also exist in a state known as a superposition. They can point in any direction other than up or down. It represents a combination of both zero and one states. The resulting state depends on the probability determined by the direction of the arrow. If the arrow points predominantly upwards, it's more likely to result in a zero, and vice versa. If it's situated exactly on the equator, either state has an equal 50% probability of occurrence.
Now you're harnessing all of these different worlds, if you will, to do all of these calculations in parallel, much faster, much more powerful, doing calculations that in a single universe would be impossible.
Unlike classical bits that function independently, qubits in a quantum computer can become entangled, forming a unified quantum state. For example, imagine two qubits in different superposition states that are not entangled. When they become entangled, the independent probabilities are disregarded, and a probability distribution is computed for all potential states, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1. This entanglement means that modifying one qubit affects the probability distribution of the entire system. It makes qubits part of a larger interconnected state.
When you'll be able to talk to expert systems, argue with them, exchange notes with expert systems. In other words, you will have a companion on the operating table, a companion when you design spaceships, a companion that has expert knowledge.
To get useful information out of a quantum computer, we need to measure the qubits. But when we do that, the system collapses and becomes like a normal computer system. And that becomes a problem. So to solve this, we use something called interference. It's like when waves in a swimming pool hit each other and cancel out. To illustrate this, imagine the qubit as a quantum wave function instead of an arrow in a 3D space. When many qubits are entangled, their wave functions combine into an overall wave function, representing the state of the quantum computer. This combination of wave results in interference, either constructively amplified to form a larger wave, or simply cancel each other out. By cleverly using interference, scientists can boost the chances of getting the right answer out of a quantum computer.
You see, quantum computers are the ultimate computers because they're computing on atoms. If there are aliens in outer space, and I think there are, it means that they also have perfected quantum computers, and they can do calculations that are far beyond anything that we can calculate with.
But a critical issue arises at this point. Once you've completed the quantum calculations, how can you be sure it's accurate? How can you confirm that your solution aligns with what would happen in reality? So let's break this down. Creating instructions for a quantum computer, also known as quantum algorithms, is a tricky business. The main reason for this is that we need to guide the computation towards the correct answer, all while not knowing what that answer is ahead of time. Let's imagine we're trying to use a quantum computer to understand the complex dynamics of a black hole. To do this, we would have to create a theoretical model of a black hole in the quantum computer, and then perform calculations on that model. The challenge, however, lies in verifying the results we get from these calculations. In the real world, we can't exactly drop a camera or a probe into a black hole to check if the quantum computer's model is accurate. Anything that gets too close to a black hole is sucked in and lost forever. This is a region known as the event horizon. This means we'd be left with results from a quantum computer's model of a black hole, but with no real-world way to confirm if these results are correct. It's like trying to solve a jigsaw puzzle without having the picture on the box to guide you. However, there have been a few big advances in creating effective quantum algorithms since 1994. A case in point is the groundbreaking work by mathematician Peter Shor. He proposed a quantum algorithm known as Shor's algorithm. The algorithm is capable of factoring large numbers exponentially faster than any known classical algorithm. You see, for a classical computer, factoring a 300-digit number would take longer than the age of the universe.
A quantum computer can conceivably break into any known digital code.
But you might be asking, why should I be afraid of a computing algorithm that can do these calculations exponentially faster? Well, the real threat in your everyday life is this: RSA encryption system. Imagine you're buying a hoodie from your favorite online store. You've picked out the hoodie, put it in your virtual cart, and you're ready to check out. But first, you need to provide your credit card information. This is sensitive data, and you wouldn't want it falling into the wrong hands. This is where RSA encryption comes into play. The information you send is jumbled up using a super complicated mathematical formula, the public key. The result is a mishmash of numbers and letters that would make no sense to anyone intercepting the data. The only one who can unlock it is the online store, using a different but related formula known as the private key. The tricky part of this system is that you can't figure out the private key from the public key unless you can solve a very difficult math problem. I mean, factoring a giant number into two primes. And like I mentioned before, it would take longer than the age of the universe with our classical computers.
This public key can be broken in principle because we do know algorithms to decompose numbers into their prime factors. But for large numbers, these algorithms take very, very long to give you a result, even on the world's presently most powerful computers.
Now, with Shor's algorithm and quantum computing, they can crack this mathematical problem easily, essentially unveiling the RSA encryption in an instant. That means your credit card could be exposed to someone with bad intentions. This is why you should care. And this is why scientists are working to develop new types of encryption that even quantum computers can't crack. That being said, in 2019, a major milestone known as quantum supremacy was reached by Google's quantum computer, Sycamore. This is a 54-qubit processor machine that used a specific algorithm called a random circuit sampling.
It's parallel processing 2 to the 53 states, which is 10 million billion. And thus that enormous amount of parallel processing is what gives it the power.
The problem involved generating a certain sequence of random numbers. The sequence had special properties, such that it was very difficult to generate from scratch. But once generated, it was relatively easy to verify the answer. And as for the verification, the team used a classical computer to check if the sequence had the right properties. In the end, it solved the problem in 200 seconds, 3 million times faster than Summit, the world's most advanced classical computer at the time. That's like comparing the speed of a snail to the speed of light. And so this is the basis for Google's claim of quantum supremacy.
The nice thing about quantum supremacy is that it is a very well-defined engineering milestone.
The race to quantum advantage, however, isn't merely a contest of speed. Remember, Sycamore had not yet implemented Shor's algorithm, because utilizing it requires a large number of qubits and robust error correction capabilities. So the quantum leap in the future will be even more significant when quantum computers start implementing Shor's algorithm.
It comes from additive codes over the field with four elements. You know, using this construction, we could find many, many, many more quantum codes.
To say the least, it would be a colossal leap forward. Not only could this threaten modern cryptographic systems, but it could also potentially revolutionize the way we understand the universe. Imagine applying the computational might of a quantum computer that is armed with Shor's algorithm, and we model a black hole's intricate dynamics. It could enable us to construct more sophisticated models. But again, there's a big challenge. How do we verify if our answers are right? One thing to do is to match the quantum computer's results with what our current scientific theories predict, things like general relativity and quantum field theory. You see, these theories have been meticulously developed over decades. They've made accurate predictions about the nature of the universe. The method of verification works in two ways. First, we could perform something called the consistency checks. This involves feeding the quantum computer with problems that we already know the answer to from general relativity. If the quantum computer spits out the same answers, we can have more confidence in the accuracy of its computation. Secondly, we could apply the results from quantum computations to scenarios where these theories contradict each other. For example, both quantum field theory and general relativity struggle to explain what happens at the very center of a black hole. If a quantum computer provides insights that align with observable phenomena and don't conflict with established physical laws, then it adds credibility to those results. To illustrate this, let's take a look at what happened when an experimental physicist used Google's quantum computer to study a wormhole.
We're looking for a peak, that's the qubit making it through the wormhole. I'm watching the data as it comes out. There's a little bit of a noisy peak. At first I was like, this is probably just noise artifact, but as the data kept coming and the peak kept getting clearer, it was like, this is a wormhole.
Physicists also rely on empirical observations to test these results as computed by quantum machines. Thanks to projects like LIGO and Virgo, we've been able to quote-unquote listen to black holes merging. It's done by detecting ripples they make in space-time. We then compare the quantum computer's results with these observations. All these techniques allow us to cross-check the quantum computer's output against established theories and observable phenomena. It's a bit like building a Lego model based on the picture on the box. The more your creation begins to resemble that picture, the more confident you become that you're on the right track. So quantum computers are a new tool in our inventory. They have the power to peek into the universe's secrets or to tear through our digital defenses. It's important to remember that we're opening a door to infinite possibilities that our minds can't yet fully grasp.